So the other stuff that we'll talk about, which is related to other non-aqueous phase liquids, is unsaturated flow. And this is the kind of parting shot for this. And it really relies on all the material that we've talked about so far. And so maybe we don't need to belabor it. But unsaturated flow is talking about the vado zone. We've talked before about the fact that these ways of looking at multi-phase flow have grown up in at least a few different disciplines. So, well, I guess, yeah, groundwater hydrology, which mainly deals with saturated flow, soil physics and agronomy, which looks at unsaturated flow, where the non-wetting fluid is typically air in the vado zone, and petroleum engineering, where the multi-phase flow, water is the wetting fluid, and typically oil is the non-wetting fluid, and they're much larger pressures. But they all rely on basically the same backgrounds, the same concepts that are used. When we talk about unsaturated flow, the one thing that is slightly different is the terminology that's used. And so we've used ideas of capillary pressure. And agronomists use this term called matrix potential. So that's what we'll talk about. Potential. And it's often given this term psi, I guess it is. And it's often a function of saturation of water. But of course, agronomists don't use saturation typically. They usually use moisture content, which is given this symbol or moniker is theta. And so you'll remember, hopefully you remember, the idea that you could define a head, hydraulic grade line, you might remember from fluids type things. Hydraulic grade line is the same as a hydraulic head. Attach that. And often we refer to it as uppercase H, certainly in 303. But it's the sum of three components. A velocity head, which in all groundwater flows, is the velocity term is so small that we typically throw it away. And if we're dealing with Darcy flow, we deal with pressure head, pressure divided by unit weight of water, plus elevation head, which we use as uppercase H or lowercase h. So this is total hydraulic head, pressure head, elevation head. So agronomists substitute this pressure head with what they call matrix potential. And it's in units, it's actually what we call pressure head, I guess. And so in the saturated zone, this is always just a function of, it's not a function of anything, it's just a parameter. But in the vado zone, because saturations vary or moisture contents vary, then matrix potential also varies as a function of saturation. And we kind of know that, right? Because we've drawn all of these figures. And so the figure that we could use to describe this, instead of, you've seen this many times, instead of saturation of water being between 0 and 100%, and capillary pressure divided by unit weight of a fluid, you could also plot this as matrix potential, be exactly the same, and this would be volumetric moisture content, which would be zero water, and where the pore space is completely filled, where the 100% saturation part would just be the porosity. And so we've talked about those being the two ranges. And so it's just a different terminology that's being used. And so you should know about it because it's important, because you'll see lots of figures that exist in either of these two ways. So the left-hand side and the top are the domain of the agronomists and soil physicists, and the right-hand side and the bottom are the domain of petroleum engineers. Petroleum. So that's all. So it's not rocket science. It's just a different terminology that's used. And you kind of know the significance of these before because we've talked about it. So if you understand this plot, I think you understand the first 3 weeks of this class. If you can add relative perms and calculating flow rates, those are the two key issues, I think, from this the first 3 weeks of this class, are understanding how saturations will vary in the vadose zone and in the saturated zone, both for air-water mixtures and water-NAPL mixtures. They vary, obey exactly the same laws. And if you want to look at motion of those fluids, then the information that you have to apply to deal with that is written like this, or perhaps more easily written, more understandably written in the equation that's here in terms of heads or pressures, which was behind. No, it's written in heads behind us. And all you have to worry about are ambiguities in the fact that when you define a pressure head as a head, then you have a choice of a couple of different liquids that you could divide it by, right? In the vadose zone, there's only one liquid that's there. The other's a gas. And so it makes sense that you would use the unit weight of water to divide through, and hence matrix potential is kind of an unambiguous term. But if you look below the water table with a NAPL and a water present, then if you wanted to calculate the head, you could choose to either use the wetting fluid or the non-wetting fluid as the one to divide this by, and you'd end up with two different values of this matrix potential, or this capri pressure, capri head. And so that's why there's some ambiguity in using that. And so I think it's fine that you use this expression as it is, but you need to remember that there is a certain ambiguity that makes that not 100% correct, but good enough for this class. And so if you understand this, then the vadose zone allows us to be able to say something about distribution of saturations with depth. And the only other two things that I want to talk about is, am I giving you whiplash? Are that there are a couple of relationships which allow you to say something very useful about, in one case, capri pressure versus saturation relationships, and the other case, in terms of capri pressure versus saturation relationships, but also relative permeability versus saturation relationships. And so this is a practical matter. So no theory per se, but more a practical matter of how, if you're practicing in this area, practicing as in doing this, not as in getting better at something, but working in this area, how do you choose what these capri pressure curves should look like? Well, you kind of know, right? Because some of you already drew up today the fact that you can draw these capri pressure curves as we've seen them before. And do you like me doing this, or do you want me to just scribble it down? Does this make you nauseous or put you into epileptic seizures? So one of you drew on this thing already, right? One group to the far right on the board, put the x-plot, right? You have this x-plot where you can either use these verbatim or you could use these as these so-called x-plots, which link up not very straightly between these, right? And so you could use these. And the reality is that you could probably scale relative permeabilities if you know the saturations or moisture contents, and it probably doesn't matter too much. But there are some formal ways of being able to get these curves. And they are the Van Genuchten relationships, which we've alluded to in this other part here. Okay. So let's look at them and just talk in overview. Well, we've looked at Brooks-Corey already, and so I won't do much other than to make the point that originally it was developed not for saturations but for moisture contents. In relating the moisture content you find yourself at in the soil relative to the irreducible moisture content of water, the saturated moisture content, which would actually be the porosity, right, as we said, and the irreducible moisture content of water. And these relate exactly, if you divided this through by the moisture content at which the soil is saturated, which is the porosity, by the way, then this, of course, would be what? This would be saturation. This would be the irreducible saturation of water. This would be 1. And this would be the irreducible saturation of water. Right? You can show that for yourself. All we're doing is we're taking this expression, which is Brooks-Corey expression, defines the moisture content that you find yourself at in the soil relative to the end member irreducible water saturation, the fully saturated saturation, which is the porosity, and the pressure that you find yourself in the soil at, and the bubbling pressure. So in other words, at that particular location in the soil, the two parameters that you'd have are the capillary pressure and the moisture content. This one and this one. All these other terms are parameters, right, for a particular soil. It would have an irreducible moisture content, it would have a porosity, and it would have a bubbling pressure. This is PC0, what we've called. If there's none, one of you had this up today. And so all Brooks Corey is, so if you take this, subtract it off to the left-hand side, if you divide both sides by this term here, then you end up with this relationship. That's all. And it's an empirical relationship that if you use actual data for these material properties of the irreducible moisture content and the bubbling pressure, and you measure for that soil the capillary pressure and how it changes with saturation, then you can plot it in terms of this term here, which is an effective saturation. And if you think about what it is, what is it? This should kind of explain it. You've seen this plot many times. This is the saturation of water, 0, 1. Irreducible saturation of water is this. And so 1 minus the irreducible saturation, of course, is this length here. Well, at least we didn't hear the expulsion of it. What's it called? So when you do that? Expectorate. You know what expectorate means? Oh, come on. This really is an education, isn't it? Expectorate. There you go. Oh, did you get it?
Yeah, little speaker.
Where is it? Oh, yeah. Oh, I learned something.
Expectorate.
Please do not
expectorate
in public. You'd get caned for that in Singapore. Do you know that? I think, yeah. Yeah, there's a decade ago, there's some unfortunately American kid who damaged a Mercedes, so they were going to cane him, and they did cane him. So yeah. Chewing gum on the subway and spitting in Singapore, don't do it. So that's besides the point. So where were we before I was distracted. So 1 minus SW0 is the denominator on this, and S minus SW0 would be, so this is the saturation that you find yourself at, not very good English, and so S minus, so this distance here, right, is S minus SW0. So this term isn't any kind of bizarre behavior. All you're doing is that instead of using the whole range at which you evaluate this saturation, you just cut it off here and ignore everything to the left of that line. And so 1 minus saturation, irreducible saturation of water is the denominator, and the numerator is just the length you are away from the irreducible saturation. And so when you're at this point here, the effective saturation is 100%. When you're at this point here, then your effective saturation is 0%. Whereas if you're doing just the regular saturation, it would be 10%, right? So all it's doing is changing the range. And so that's what that is, and it relates it relative to the bubbling pressure, which is PB. So that's all Brooks Corey is. So they just recognized that if you plotted things in this particular way, you could plot them, and that you'd end up with this very simple expression, which is basically the expression of a straight line if you take logs of this, right? So this expression and this are equivalent to each other. If you take logs of both sides and plot capillary pressures versus effective saturations, but as logs of those relationships, you get a plot that looks like this. Effective saturation defined not as a linear scale, but as a log scale. And capillary pressure is expressed not as a linear scale, but as a log scale. And so you'd expect that the 1 point that you'd know is that when you're 100% saturation, SW is equal to 1. The effective saturation is also equal to 1, right, from what we said about this. Then the coordinates of the effective saturation of 1 and the capillary pressure, the pressure that you find yourself divided by the bubbling pressure, is also going to be equal to 1, right? Because this is PB on the top. So the ordinates of this point have to be effective saturation of 1 and a ratio of the pressures of 1. And so you're at this point here. 10 to the 0. I guess if this was plotted as PC, wrong term. If it's plotted as capillary pressure of the bubbling pressure, then this value here would actually be 10 to the 0, right? It happens to be normalized by something else. So the only point I'm making is that this is basically the equation of a straight line if you think about it. Y, I don't know what algebra books in this country use for it, but Y equals MX plus C. C is 0. So it's just the equation of a straight line. Happens to be in log space. And so it has an intercept at this point here. It's a straight line. It has some gradient. The gradient of this straight line happens to be lambda. And so that's all it is. And so it's just the observation, if you like, that if you take these data from real examples and you plot them in terms of not of saturation, not of saturation, but in terms of effective saturation and in terms of capillary pressure in this form, then they all fall in a straight line. And we talked a little bit about these. These are the kinds of straight lines that you'd expect to see. So let's see what you'd expect here. So you know something about these. You know that this would be have the biggest pore in it because the entry pressure is the smallest. This would have the biggest pore in this particular media would be smaller than this one, right? That's really all we're saying. And once you invade this, you basically invade all of the pore space. So you'd think that the pores in this would be roughly the same size, but these ones would be have lots of largish pores, but also a big number of small pores. This would have a very big pore and a smaller distribution. I'm not saying it very well, but I think you understand. And so if you look at what this would mean on this other plot here, this is the entry pressure. Then the low entry pressure one here, I think, should be this one here, right? This is capillary pressure. The high entry pressure one here should be this one. And the features of this distribution, which says something about the pore sizes, this is relatively flat. You know, in the limit, you could imagine that it was really flat if it looked like this. If it was really flat, then I think this graph here would basically be almost a vertical line, right? Not quite. It's not. And I guess I've missed out these ones here, but you get the point. And of course, this case here, this one, which starts off here, of course, if it was that this was really difficult to be able to invade the rest of the space, then in the limit, this would actually look really like this, be really flat. And so the steepness of these graphs say something about the behavior. So it's just another way of being able to look at your data. And I think exactly that case is made in these cases below. Low entry pressure, all the pores are the same size and fill at the same time. Low entry pressure, it's easy to get saturation as you fill up the first pore. You also fill up the other pores, which are very close in size. And more difficult to get stuff in the first place, higher entry pressures. And as you fill it up, you're sampling a much broader distribution of pore sizes. And therefore, this green line is much flatter than this much more vertical red line. Nothing more than that. And so it's another way of being able to represent these things. Probably more than we need in this class, because typically the reason you want to have these things are that in numerical models that allow you to simulate saturation and invasion of species, you basically have to have some capillary pressure versus saturation relationship to be able to solve the equations of conservation and flow. And we're not really going into any detail in that in this class because it's beyond this class. But that's really what this kind of relationship is used for. And you should know that. It's of interest. We mentioned that there are two separate methods of defining these both capillary pressure versus saturation curves, or I suppose for agronomists, matrix potential versus volumetric moisture content curves, right? This is just this other terminology that we've used for Brooks Corey. We kind of diverted ourselves. We said what it was, and then we went back to talking in terms of saturations and capillary pressures, just because perhaps we're more familiar with that and what we've talked about in the remainder of this class. But the other way to do this is another set of relationships also developed before you were born, but more closely related to when you were born than Brooks Corey in the 1980s by Van Genuchten, which again allow us to be able to define capillary pressure, volumetric moisture contents as a function of capillary pressures and some fitting coefficients. And these fitting coefficients are values of alpha, values of n, and values of m, which are just fitting coefficients that we have to define. And the basic idea is that if the capillary pressure versus saturation curve, so you can define these in terms of moisture contents and matrix potentials, or moisture contents and capillary pressures, and saturations versus capillary pressures. That's just what these two different columns are doing. And all they're attempting to do is to represent this capillary pressure versus saturation curve in terms of an equation. And this is the equation that it represents. It's just a power law equation. And I'm not going to talk about how you would derive this, but the basic idea is if you had values, or if you had field data which gave you this curve, then what you could do is you could draw this curve, and you could use this curve to calculate the values of alpha, n, and m. And there's a protocol to be able to do that. Fetter talks about it. It's just a plug-and-chug method of being able to define the curve where the irreducible moisture saturation of water is, the 100% saturation of water is, and you manipulate some things. I'm not going to go through it. But basically, you can calculate what the values of m and n and alpha are. And they're just fitting coefficients. And they're useful because they allow you then to be able to represent this curve, which of course you might think is kind of stupid, because if you had the data to be able to make this curve in the first place, which allowed you to figure out what m and n and alpha are, why do you need to do that? Because you already got the curve. Well, the reason you might need to do it is because you might need to represent this by an equation if you're using a numerical model to do that. So that's why it's done. But the other important reason for wanting to do it for typical materials is that this method, the Van Genuchten method, also allows you to calculate what the relative permeability curve looks like to water. And so if you know what these values of n and m and alpha R, and you can typically get values of those for different materials. These are stated a slightly different way, but I'll let you look at that in your own ways. If you know what these are for, say, a sandy clay, then you can calculate exactly what the relative permeability curve looks like. And you might need to use that, because you might want to use that expression that's on the board, which is Darcy's law, which allows you to calculate flow rates. And so that's kind of closing the loop on this. And so there are methods to be able to figure out what capillary pressure versus saturation curves look like. There are methods that allow you to calculate what relative perm versus saturation curves are. You know why they're important. They're important for capillary pressure versus saturation behavior because it allows you to say something about the profile of saturations both in the vadose zone and below the water table. And they also tell you how to be able to calculate the rates at which you might be able to pull fluids through those porous media if you apply a gradient to them. And for both of those cases, looking at the saturation distribution and the rate at which you can pull fluids out of these things, you can do as back-of-the-envelope calculations where you don't need a black box model to do it. You can just use what you know about these systems. And so that's kind of hopefully what we've instilled in talking about these behaviors. And so I'll say again before we split in 1 minute's time, when we talk about multiphase flow, the key figure that we're dealing with, I think, is this. And even more so in this particular case, the fact that this figure also happens to have Darcy's law written on it, but not necessarily relative perms are not drawn out here. But you know exactly how relative perms would fit on top of these because they would look like... this, right? And so that figure really does encapsulate all the things that we might have talked about in this class so far. Okay. So I'll leave it at that. Great. I was going to say have a great weekend, but I guess it's not quite the weekend yet, right?